How y'all doing? So these are clean, by the way. Dryer, I promise. I'm heading to work here in a little bit. Actually got a lead for this. Larry's a superhero to me. So I wanted to come and do this. I told my mom I couldn't sing. They always want me to sing. I'll never talk. I ain't good. But I told her I wanted to come and introduce Larry. And sometimes I think about that place where, I got saved. I learned to be a man. I learned a lot of things out there. And I think about sometimes, me and Larry would have talks about how it all started. And just to put something in your head about all this, from what I've gathered from our conversation, I'd like to ask y'all a few questions. How many of us would move out to the middle of a big old flooded out, mosquito ridden swamp land then start clearing out trees and making roads, letting our family do without to invest money into a place to help other men that we haven't even met yet? How many of us would let this 25 to probably 75 thieves and liars, murderers, everything you could imagine, live in our backyard with our family, our wife, our children, our grandkids? How many of us would have enough faith to do that? How many of us would keep going when we're trying to figure out ways to help support this place and God tells you to go plant some watermelons? How many of us throw our hands up and walk away at that point? How many wives would stay with a man crazy enough to believe in all this? When I first got to Potter's Well, I was like many addicts. I hated myself, but at the same time, I thought that everything was about me and revolved around me. And I was angry and bitter, and I thought I knew everything. And I thought, yeah, I have a drug problem, and I'm not stupid enough to do it again once I've gotten off of it. And I hated everything about Potter's Wheel. Mm-hmm. I hated that it challenged me, that it forced me to follow the rules they expected me to work to help pay for my food and where I live, and this bill that I wasn't going to be able to pay for. I'd say 95% of the men that go through there, that's how the bills are paid. We work. Larry says all the time, Jesus is the solution, and the pallets pay the bills.
That's right.
You know, we had to work 6 hours a day, not even that, take out breaks. We go to class and all that, but how many of us wish we could only have to work about 5 hours a day now to have a place to live and eat? I quit after 2 months, first time there. I had my parents believing that it was like Cool Hand Luke out there. He'd ride on a horse with a shotgun and threaten to kill us. And this was the craziest place you could imagine. And then, like most families, they believed me and they came and saved me.
Yep.
And then about a year later, I think, almost exactly a year later, I went to a rehab down in Atlanta. And I don't know anything about the place. It might be an all right place, but I walked out of there and called my mom and said, I go get back to that pallet shop. And she said, you told me you had a gun. And he was talking about shooting people. I said, yeah, I made all that up.
That's true.
I don't know what it was. Something told me I had to go back to that place. I went back, and Larry and I were just talking about it back there. I went from being absolutely defeated to Chad, the immortal. I was like arrogant and full of myself. He taught me pride. And he taught me how to believe in myself and how to push myself. And I went from one extreme to the other. Boy, he couldn't do nothing with me. Mm. I think after about 17 or 18 times of getting in trouble, he finally put me out.
Yeah.
And that's a lot more chances than most people get. But he saw something in me, and He had enough faith in God to know that he could put me out there and let me fail and know that I would come back to finish what was started there. And he told me after, right about 20 minutes after he told me I had to leave, he put his hat on and his coat and he hugged me and he told me he loved me. He said, I can come back after 30 days. That's the rule. You come on back if you need it. If you need me, if you need to be here, you come back. So sure enough, I came back. Came back again. This time, there's something about God when you get saved. He don't let you do drugs no more. It ain't fun. I think that last time I lasted about 2 weeks before my whole life fell apart. Everybody knew about it and everything was just going crazy. So I went on back out there before I got in real bad shape like I had been before. And this time I ended up staying, and this place that I once hated so much became something that I loved and defended and helped with everything I had to give back and support. First Larry taught me how to believe in myself, and then he taught me how to get other men to believe in themselves. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of great things in my life, my family, my daughter, Holly, my job, I love my work. But there was nothing as fulfilling as what I did out there. I had one room in a staff house with a little TV. My parents had bought me a DVD player. Larry throws his staff members some money every week so we can enjoy ourselves, go out to eat and buy things that we want to need there. It was simple, but it was one of the most powerful things that probably ever happened in my life, one of the greatest moments of my life, to be able to watch so many men come in there broken down and defeated, watch them get saved, watch light bulbs go off in their heads as they come to understand what they've been doing to themselves and everyone around them, watch them go from weak and sick and tired at work to literally blocking out pain and fatigue to carry a little more of a load for the men around them that come in after them that are now sick and tired and coming off drugs. And that's what we do. You learn to carry the load for the next man. And then he comes up and he does it for the next man. And all along out there, you got a bunch of guys who cared nothing for anything but themselves and would steal and lie and do anything they could, burn everything down around them just for 1 minute of a good feeling from a drug. And you watch these men turn into leaders and people who sacrifice and people who push themselves and push the ones around them who will reach back and grab a man who's fallen and pull him along. You see guys trying to leave there and guys running up the bat to get them and talk them out of it. You see guys come in there who hate church. Mm-hmm. And by the end of it, that's all they can talk about. You see guys who are scared to speak in front of a crowd or scared to pray, and by the end of it, they're your prayer warriors, they're your leaders. You see men get healed and break down in tears. They're unashamed now to talk about their past, the things that have happened to them and things that they've done. And you watch them find freedom from those things, and you watch them grow stronger. And, Larry is faith. That's what I think about when I think about him. I got so many stories, just stuff like we were at work. I ran that shop for him for a while, and we had a bunch of loads to get out, no wood. And we talked about this on the phone. And we went to the office, had a meeting. I said, Larry, I don't know what we're gonna do, buddy. We got to put out about 2,500 pallets, and I got about 200 used ones out here to work with. And he said, we're going to go pray. And I rolled my eyes in my head. But sure enough, like when Jesus told his boys to throw the net over the side of the boat when they said they're going to fish, that boy came in. Amen. I watched him come up to a couple of mechanics who were getting ticked off at a forklift. A bunch of boys that are complaining about having to pick up things with their hands. God forbid, we got to do physical work. They wanted that forklift to work. He said, that thing will work when Jesus wants it to work. I like this in your life, but there's some money that, you know, my parents love me, but nobody knows how to deal with people like me or Scotty, Larry. So someone has been there. And Larry's been there. And he's got one of the firmest hands I've ever come in contact with and one of the most forgiving hearts. Mm. And that's what it takes to really teach a man how to be a Christian man and how to be a leader. It changed my life. And he'll tell you it was all God, but I know there's a lot of hard work on his part that went into doing what he does for guys like me. And just want to thank you, Larry and Miss Sandra. All your sacrifices, all the time, worry, 24/7, 365 days a year, that man is working. I've seen him in the middle of the night roll up in his PJs on a golf cart. Because somebody is putting at risk what he's built out there, or somebody's boys got hurt. I heard him tell me one of the hardest parts of his job is whenever he has to do the right thing by all of those men out there trying to get their life right by putting out one who doesn't want it. That boy dies and his mama calls him and tells him, "My son's dead if you kick him out." Larry told me one time that he didn't take that job or that calling because of the thank yous, because it's a thankless job. You sure you have the men to come through and they're thankful, but you have so many more that want to bash what you're doing because you challenge evil and you challenge evil in people and you won't let it live in your backyard where you're trying to do good work in all these other people's lives. Larry takes a very personal responsibility for what he's doing out there. He sat me down one time because I was one of those that didn't want to call somebody out on some of their wrongdoings because I didn't want the judgment. I wanted to be cool. He said, "Chad, we are killing these boys if we don't hold them accountable." So we are killing these boys. I love you, Larry, and I'm glad you're here. That's all I got.